Okay, very good. Thank you, Pastor Yvonne. Praise you. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you for your hard work. Pastor Yvonne has been out, she don't want me to say it, but she has been out really blessing some people. I won't go into detail. Blessing some people today again.
Oh, I shared it with
Blessings
them.
upon it. Oh, you already shared it. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I had lunch dates today. Crazy. Okay, let me know when you're ready.
I'm ready. Yes, get going. Yes.
Okay.
All righty. Okay, we're going to start out today. Today's message, we're talking about it. We're in First Peter, verse 1, and maybe a little 2. We'll we go as far as we can with time limit. So we're talking about the title, give it the title, for lack of a better word, Turn the Other Cheek. Peter wrote this message to the Christians in a place where they were being persecuted and hurt like never before from all sides. And so he was telling them that they could not fight back the way the world fight back. And that's important today to talk about because we are coming up on a time period where we're going to want to be sometime be kind of maybe tempted to fight back where we were fight back. But we are stronger when we are walking in love and turning the other cheek. So we really want to be spiritually strong. So we want to let the world know that we are Christians. So play the song, Cassie Vaughn.
By our love, yes, they'll know. that together. Ready? Oh, by our love. That's right.
By our love.
Help me out, brother.
Peter chapter 1. Peter teaches Christians to be strong, good servants, and how to turn the other cheek. Now, that's a picture of what some artists think Peter may have looked like. A rugged man who, a fisherman job was very hard then. Turn the other cheek in Matthew chapter 5, verses 38-39 says, you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whoever slapped you on your right cheek, turn to him the other also. Now that was something that was done and talked about in the nation of Israel. So I have a great teacher who can share that in detail, probably better than I can. So let's show the next little video, Pastor Yvonne. Now, what does it turn the other cheek really mean? Dr. Brown is Jewish, yes.
So someone breaks into your house. You're a married man with two little children. Someone breaks into your house, and next thing they're standing over you. And do you say, oh, well, Jesus told me to turn the other cheek. So you want just hurt me, or you hurt my wife too. In fact, the kids are down the hallway. Is that what I mean? No. It has nothing to do with self-defense. It has to do with personal retaliation. And in fact, if we look at in Matthew chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus says, do not resist the one who is evil, but if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. It's in the context of eye for eye, tooth for tooth legislation. And what he's saying is this. Notice, if someone slaps you on the right cheek, okay, so here's my right hand. You presume right-handedness in Scripture. If I slap you with my right hand, what cheek am I slapping? I'm slapping your left cheek. If I smite you on the right cheek, if I slap you on the right cheek, what does that mean? Boom, a backhanded slap. Jewish law that was developing at that time, as far as we know, was current at that time, says that if someone gives you a backhanded slap in public, you are entitled to certain compensation in the courts. And then if they give you a regular slap, it's half that compensation. But for public shaming, you can now retaliate in the courts. He's saying, no. Don't fight back in that respect. Don't retaliate personally. Don't go for personal vindication, and someone humiliates you publicly, now you're going to take them to court and sue them and try to get what you can. No. Overcome evil with good. That's the Jesus way. And that's how we see Jesus himself behaving. When he is mistreated, he doesn't mistreat in return. When he is reviled, he doesn't revile in return. Instead, he dies for those very people. But this has nothing whatsoever to do with self-defense, and it has nothing whatsoever to say America getting involved in World War II to take out the Nazis. That was a good thing to do and a thing God blessed. So let's interpret this. It's a radical verse, but let's interpret it rightly.
Amen. That was a very- very good explanation. In other words, you are supposed to protect your family. There's a right for police officers to do what they have to do when they have to maybe take somebody out, just like soldiers and that. Turning the other cheek, meaning you don't go looking for something to do in order to get retaliation. Like you said, you don't take people to court. And like the song was saying, you will know them, you are Christians by the way you react and not do things like that in that sense. But you are to protect your wife and protect your family, you know, with whatever it takes to protect them. Returning good for evil or turning the other cheek may sound noble, and Christians agree that it is the right thing to do. However, in the midst of trials and persecution, showing kindness to our persecutors can be extremely difficult. The Christians of the Asia Minor who received this letter from Peter has discovered this. They had found that a life lived for God is often a life of many difficulties. Before we go to the next video, were there any questions about what Dr. Brown had said? Did anybody have any questions about that or comment? Okay, if not, then go to the next slide, Pastor Yvonne. Peter was the author of this letter and writes to Christians living in Asia Minor, which is now modern-day Turkey, which has been in the news quite a bit now. He identified them as people who live in light of their relationship to God the Father and God the Holy Spirit and God the Son. A lot of things was going on in Turkey, and I'm going to let this video, the next video, come up, explain it to you in detail. Now, this is the area that it's in. This is what it looked like. For you people who geography folks or history, you can look and see what was going on in there. For the Bible scholars, that's an area of, you know, the Black Sea, the Mediterranean Sea, all those places are familiar and in the news today there. Peter received a special commission from the Lord to act with official authority as God's representative among believers in order to carry God's message to them, to the people in the Asia Minor. Now, this is Turkey today. This is a video about biblical Turkey. It's got a lot of good information in this video.
Hi everyone, in today's 1,000 plus subscriber special video, we will take a brief look at the geography, history and archaeology of the city of Ephesus and its connection with the Bible. The ancient city of Ephesus is located in modern day southwestern Turkey, which in the 1st century AD was a part of the Roman province known as Asia or Asia Minor, and was situated along the eastern coast of the Aegean Sea in the Caistor Valley beside the Caistor River. In biblical times, the city of Ephesus was connected directly to the Aegean Sea by its famous harbour. However, due to continual silting that was caused by the river, the harbour continued to gradually shrink in size over the centuries, in spite of many different attempts to resolve the issue and even attempts to dredge the harbour. However, these ancient attempts to keep the city connected to the sea ultimately failed, and the once port city of ancient Ephesus is now landlocked, about 5 miles or 8 kilometers away from the sea. In ancient times though, its prime location meant that it had easy access to both the Mediterranean sea trade and travel routes and land access to central Anatolia and beyond through the valley. The New Testament city that Paul visited in the 1st century AD was located in a valley between two small mountains, Mount Korosos to the southwest and Mount Pion to the northeast, which divided the city into upper and lower sections. However, before the 1st century AD, the city had been moved at least twice, once by Croesus, king of Lydia in the 6th century BC, and then again to its current location by Lysimachus in the 3rd century BC, where it remained until it was abandoned in the 15th century AD. The modern-day Turkish town of Selçuk is located close to the ancient city. The history of Ephesus dates back to at least the 2nd millennium BC, when it was originally the site of a royal Hittite city of Apaza, from whence the later name Ephesus seems to have originated, which functioned as a regional Hittite capital of Erzurum within the Empire of the Hittites in western Turkey. According to Strabo's geography, Greek legends declared that the city was founded by the Amazons. By about the 11th century BC, the city fell under the control of Ionian Greek colonizers from Athens, though a mix of local Anatolians and Greeks appeared to have lived in the now predominantly Greek city. The Greeks believed that the city was founded by a man called Androclus, the son of King Codros of Athens, after an oracle declared that he should go and found a new city. The city continued under Greek control until about 560 BC, when the nearby Lydians under King Croesus took control of Ephesus. However, the Lydian control of the city proved to be short-lived, as in 546 BC, the city fell under control of the Persian Achaemenid Empire, when Cyrus, who is also known as Cyrus the Great, defeated Croesus and took control of his kingdom. Persian control of the city then continued until 334 BC, when the city fell under the control of Alexander the Great, after he defeated the Persian forces in western Anatolia. With the sudden and unexpected death of Alexander the Great in 323 BC in Babylon, much of Anatolia, including Ephesus, eventually fell under the control of one of his generals, Lysimachus, who then renamed the city Ercyonia after his wife Arsinoe, though the city name reverted back to Ephesus after his death. Besides moving the city, which he apparently did according to Strabo's geography, by deliberately having the old city's drainage system blocked during a storm, which then flooded the city after its citizens were reluctant to move to the new location, he also surrounded the city with a 5-mile or 8-kilometer long city wall, which is still partially preserved to this day in the surrounding mountains. The city then fell under the control of the Greek Seleucid Empire, which was based in Syria, after Seleucus I defeated Lysimachus in 281 BC. This situation remained so until 188 BC, when the city came under the rule of the pro-Roman Attalid Kingdom, which was centered at Pergamum to the north. The Attalid dynasty ruled the region and city for Rome until 133 BC, when King Attalus I gave his entire kingdom, which included Ephesus, to Rome in his will. Ephesus was then later made the Roman capital of the Roman province of Asia, which had previously been located at Pergamum, in about 27 BC by the Emperor Augustus, and it was also declared to be a free city, which allowed it to govern itself and forbade the posting of Roman soldiers within it. The city reached its high point in the Roman period. During this time, the city had an estimated population of anywhere between 100,000 or possibly as high as 300,000 people living within it, which made it one of the largest cities in the entire Roman Empire after Rome, Antioch, and Alexandria. The importance of the city is evidenced by Roman inscriptions which state that it was the first and greatest metropolis of Asia. The wealth of Ephesus is also demonstrated by the remarkable preserved remains of Roman terrace houses that were uncovered in the city. The importance of the city and its connection with the rest of the world may have been one reason why Paul chose to stay in the place for so long, in fact for over 2 years, during his third missionary journey in the mid-1st century AD, which stay and what he did during it is found recorded in Acts chapter 19. A significant church was apparently established there, based on the fact that much of the New Testament was either sent to or addressed to people within this particular church, which strongly implies its relative importance amongst the churches in the 1st century AD. These include the epistles of Ephesians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, and the book of Revelation. Extra-biblical tradition also states that the Apostle John may have lived at Ephesus in the latter part of the 1st century AD, before and after his exile to the nearby island of Patmos. It is also said that he eventually died there, and that the remains of a nearby Byzantine basilica church is said to be the place that marked the site of his burial. The city was most famous in the ancient world due to its strong connection with the Greek goddess Artemis, who was named Diana by the Romans. This connection with a goddess and Ephesus appears to date back to the 2nd millennium BC and to an Anatolian goddess known as the Sibyl or Tyche, who was apparently worshipped there. Artemis, who was the daughter of Zeus and twin sister of Apollo, was a virgin goddess and was patron of hunting, wild animals, childbirth, and virginity. The goddess was worshipped at a temple known as the Artemisian, just outside the city of Ephesus. A temple began to be built by Croesus in about 550 BC and apparently took 120 years to be completed, though it appears that three earlier and smaller temples had been built on the spot before Croesus' project, which dates to about the 8th century BC and afterwards. Croesus' structure was then, according to the ancient historian Theopompus, burnt down in 356 BC by a man called Herostratus, who thought that by doing this deed, he would be forever famous. Rather than becoming famous, he was instead killed by the angry citizens of Ephesus and would become forever infamous amongst them for his sacrilegious deed, to the point that the people of Ephesus would not speak his name. Greek and Roman tradition also claims that on the night that the temple was burnt down, Alexander the Great was born in Macedon. Alexander apparently offered to help rebuild the destroyed temple, but the Ephesians refused his offer and eventually built an even grander structure, one of the largest Greek temples ever built, which was considered one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. The temple was, however, destroyed in 262 AD by the Goths and was never rebuilt. Little remains of the famous structure today, besides its foundations and parts of its 127 marble columns and bases. The city's strong connection with Artemis or Diana can be clearly seen in the New Testament book of Acts in chapter 19 verses 23 to 42. As during Paul's ministry at the city, a near riot took place after a man named Demetrius, who was a local silversmith, stirred up an angry mob against Paul and his companions because his preaching and ministry had apparently negatively impacted their business of selling small images of the goddess to the people who made pilgrimage to the city and its renowned temple so as to worship the goddess. Near the theatre Ephesus, where two of Paul's companions were taken by the angry mob, a monumental public inscription was discovered that mentions that there was a place of the silversmiths located within the city, which helps to demonstrate the presence of a number of silversmiths and their influence within the city, which helps to confirm the account given in Acts chapter 19 of the importance and influence of the silversmiths within Ephesus. The city was also strongly associated with the worship of the Roman emperors, known as the Imperial Cult, with a temple to the Emperor Augustus being built there in 11 to 13 AD. Later temples to the family of the Flavian dynasty, which consisted of the emperors Vespasian, Titus, and Domitian, and the Emperor Hadrian, were also constructed there. Ephesus also gained a strong association with the production and use of magic charms and spells, the most famous being called the Ephesian letters, which were believed to give its owner and reader good fortune in many different areas of life, and even the ability to cast out and ward away demons. This production of spells at Ephesus and its importance is evident in Acts chapter 19 verse 19, where many people in Ephesus, after becoming Christians, destroyed their costly spells by burning them. The city is also recorded in Acts chapter 9 verse 8 as having a Jewish community and synagogue, which Paul preached in for 3 months. Josephus several times mentions the presence of Jews within the city and the special and quite unusual rights that they enjoyed as citizens of Ephesus, which they had received after the time of Alexander the Great, and which rights were later confirmed by Rome. Evidence of a Jewish presence at the city can also be seen in a piece of graffito that depicts a Jewish menorah, or the seven-branch candlestick that had once been in the temple at Jerusalem, on the steps of the 2nd century AD Library of Celsus, which was located in the center of Ephesus. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to leave a like, comment, and subscribe for more new videos.
Okay, now that video, the reason I showed that video, it's got a lot of good information on that. Pastor Yvonne has been just did a teaching on the book of Acts, and we talked about that. She showed some of Jonathan Cahn about the return of the God after he came back, especially Diana, and not just in America, but all over the world. But Bible scholar, really take a second look at that video when I send it out, and do some research on Turkey, the land, what's going on in Turkey now, how they are turning their back on Israel, threatening to attack Israel, and all kinds of things in that. So back to the lessons, as a greeting to the elect pilgrims, back to 1 Peter, greetings, and an apostle of Jesus Christ to the pilgrims, to the dispersions in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Now, this is a song of holiness, a servant's song. I really enjoy this song. I hope you really enjoy it also. We are servants. Our are servants. That's why we are here. Pilgrims. If the questions about anything, we'll get started with what's a pilgrim. Pilgrims, these believers do not, when you're a pilgrim in a place, you don't belong where you are. These believers do not belong to the world around them, but to a heavenly world. We are pilgrims right here on planet Earth. Dispersion. This term conveys the idea of being scattered among strangers, much like the Jewish exiles of the Old Testament who were not living in their homeland, but in Babylon. Remember Daniel, Meshach, and Abednego and all the people? They was dispersed. And another definition, read that for me, Pastor Yvonne.
Pontus, Bithynia. Peter addressed his letters to the believers in the provinces of Asia Minor. This region had been thoroughly evangelized by Paul during his missionary journeys.
Remember the book of Acts when Pastor Yvonne did such a great job of doing that? Okay, go ahead.
Verse number two. Uh-huh. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience and sprinkling out the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace be multiplied.
Now, I got those letters in black that I really want to put emphasis on and talk about tonight. The first one, we'll start with sanctification. Sanctified or sanctification. We used to call it back in the old days, sanctified folks. And we, as a kid, we used to make fun of them because they were trying to live like Jesus, and we thought it was kind of funny that they did so. But now I am trying to be one of those folks there. So sanctification. Sanctification involved more than a mere moral reformation of character brought by the power of truth. It is the work of the Holy Spirit bringing the whole nature more and more under the influence of the new gracious principle and planted in the souls in regenerations. And it might sound like a big word to some, but in other words, sanctification is to carry on to perfection. Something popped up on my screen, 1 second. Carrying on to perfection the work we began in regeneration. And it extends to the whole man. And that's found, I left those scriptures in there, the reference, and really do a research of each one of these scriptures about sanctification and perfection. We won't be perfect in this world, but we are to really work hard at trying to be perfect like Jesus was perfect. And that's found in Romans 6:13 and on and on. You can change it. It is the special office of the Holy Spirit in the plans of redemption to carry on his work. And that's found again in 1 Corinthians and also 1 Thessalonians. Faith is instrumental in securing sanctification. Pray and ask God to give you the gift of faith. Faith is instrumental in securing sanctification in as much as it has secure union to Christ. And that's found in Galatians chapter 2:20. And bring the believer into living contact with the truth where he is yield to obedience and to the commands, and then trembling at threatening and embracing the promise of God for this life and that which is to come. In other words, you're going to be very obedient. There's a scripture that talks about obedience is better than sacrifice. The Old Testament has sacrifices and stuff like that. But when you're obedient in the New Testament, it's much better than sacrifice. But we still ought to follow the command. You could say the Ten Commandments. You're following everything that is in the Bible. In other words, you are trying to be perfect like Jesus Christ was perfect. Perfect sanctification is not attainable in this life. And let's mention that. And that's found in 1 Kings and Proverbs and Ecclesiastes and James. This is going to be a good video to share with people around you, just for the simple fact of this good definition. This came out of a very good Bible dictionary. See Paul's account of Rome. See Paul's account of himself in Romans 7:14 and 1 Timothy 1:15. Also, the confession of David in Psalm 19 and in 19:12 and 19:13 and in Psalm 51. Really read Psalms 51. The definitions in the Bible dictionaries is different versions of it. Look up all the dictionaries, the Bible dictionaries, and you Google Bible dictionary, it gives some good choices there. The more holy a man is, the more humble and self-renouncing and self-abhorrent, and the more sensitive to sin he becomes. And the more closely he will cling to Christ. The more you try to be holy, the more you will try to be like Christ, to put it simple. The more holy you try to live. And 1 Peter, 1 and 2 Peter is a book about living in holiness. The moral imperfections which cling to him, he feels to be sin, which he laminated, he will try to get rid of. The more holy you try to live, the more less sin you will find in your life. Would you like to comment on that, Pastor Yvonne? Your partner can do a better job than that, okay?
That's
okay.
The closer you get to the Lord, the less you want to be involved in the things of the world. It just happens.
Yes. As believers, we ought to work hard to find out what are things in the world that we should come away from. With the Holy Spirit living in us, he's constantly reminding us that we should not be involved with this, we should not be involved with that. But sometimes we lack a thing so much until we would kind of override the Holy Spirit's prompt in our life. Believers find that their lives is a constant warfare, and that's what I was talking about. They need to take the kingdom of heaven by storm and watch and pray. We're really going through that right now like never before. We're in a constant battle. If you're not in a battle, then something is really kind of, you're not really out there, you're not made yourself available to be a soldier to fight the battle that is going on. If you make yourself available to do the things that God would have us to do, then you are going to be in a battle. They are always subject to the constant chastisement of the Father's loving hand, which can only be designed to correct their imperfection and to conform their graces. Sanctification is the ongoing process whereby the Holy Spirit works in believers, making their lives holy. Separate their old ways and to God in order to be more like him. The old things that we used to do was the old song used to say, the things I used to do, I don't do anymore. It's an ongoing process whereby the Holy Spirit works in believers, making their lives holy. When you that start taking place, that's when you are strong with the Lord, that you can start winning those battles that was talked about in the last slide. Now let's talk about obedience. Read obedience for me, Pastor Yvonne.
Obedience is better than sacrifice. The most important thing we can do as Christians is to be obedient to the word of God.
Okay. What words of God should we be obedient to? Should be obedient to the whole Bible, or should we pick and choose? We should be obedient to the whole word of God. When we study the Bible, and that's why it's so important to really study the Bible, look up word definition, and then be obedient to the word of God. Then you'll find yourself less and less walking in sin. You are headed toward perfection there. Okay, the next one you had talked about in that one group in 1 Peter chapter 1 was the sprinkling of the blood. This concept, the second reason why God chose us is to draw our attention to three situations in the Old Testament when the Israelites were sprinkled with the blood of animals. Moses sprinkling the blood on the Israelites at Mount Sinai to symbolize their initiation into the Old Covenant. The sprinkling of Aaron and his son to be the priest of Israel, and the sprinkling of blood performed by priests over healed lepers to symbolize their cleansing. And any of these cases should be one that Peter had in mind when he was talking about the sprinkling of blood. Now, you don't have to get literal blood anymore. You just use the word of God when you pray for people, or you anoint them with oil in that sense. A heavenly inheritance. This is found in verse 3 in 1 Peter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. According to his abundant mercies, our salvation is grounded in God's mercy. His act of compassion toward us, despite our condition of sinfulness, has begotten us again. God has given believers a new spiritual life that enables us to live in an entirely different disposition than the one of our physical birth allows, to a living hope. Hope does not imply a wishfulness, but rather a dynamic confidence that does not end with this life, but continue to throughout eternity. Through the resurrection. Although this phrase may modify the phrase to a living hope, the context suggests that it is to be understood as the meaning of our salvation rather than the meaning of hope. In other words, we'll be totally saved once we won't be totally saved until we are really in heaven with God and totally perfection. Some of their troubles, the people that was in Asia Minor, came from their neighbors, while some came from the government authorities. Peter wrote to these Christians to encourage them, to explain to them why suffering occurs, and to remind them of their eternal reward at the end of this earthly life. That's our great hope. Moreover, Peter, having been with Jesus, must have learned how to express himself from the master communicator, Jesus himself. As one of the first teachers and preachers of the gospel, Peter would have been able to express himself very good in Greek because he was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit was giving him things to say and things to write. If his own Greek style was not sufficiently polished, Peter could have certainly have dictated this letter, perhaps to his Servanus, who would have been polished and writing and doing the things that Peter needed to say. In other words, the Holy Spirit was going to get this message out regardless of what had to be done in that. Peter was not an educated person, but the Holy Spirit educated him to do the things that he had to do. Uh, That letter of Peter reflects ideas similar to those found in the writing of the Apostle Paul, is understandable because the two men knew each other. Peter had read Paul's letters, and both men was under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. That's what I said before. Thus, finding Pauline concept in this letter is not a strong argument that Peter was not the author of this letter. Peter wrote this letter.
And Pauline is Paul's epistle.
Pauline means that Paul, you know, Paul did not write the letter, but Peter wrote the letter. Any other comments you got, Pastor Yvonne?
No, I was just making sure they understood that the word Pauline refers to all of the letters that Paul wrote, the Pauline epistles.
Okay. Okay, read the next one for me.
Finally, the sporadic and local persecution before Nero's reign, which it was before AD 68, is the persecution that Peter is probably addressing in this letter. Although severe official persecution did not begin until the reigns of Domitian, AD 95, and Trajan, AD 112, early Christians experienced oppressive local persecution from the beginning. You wanted to stop there? Mm-hmm. Go on.
Go on. Uh-huh.
Okay. Verse 4. You want me to read that?
Yeah, keep going. Yeah.
Oh, okay. To an inherited, incorruptible, and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. So the Greek word translated inheritance here suggests both a present and a future reality. God has already determined what we will one day experience in its totality. The word reserved, God has set aside in heaven a wonderful inheritance that is waiting for us even now. Okay, verse 5. Who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation ready to be revealed in the last time? God keeps his people safe from external attacks and safe within the protective boundaries of his kingdom. And revealed, the word revealed, we do not now see or understand fully the salvation that God has prepared for us, but one day we will. One day we will. Keep going?
Yes.
Okay. Verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. Grieved. While there is much rejoicing because of the salvation God has prepared for us, there will also be agony because of the pressures and difficulties of life and by various trials. And in this context, trials refers to ordeals that we encounter in life rather than those things that would induce us to sin, just normal everyday things. Mm-hmm. So note that no one problem is in view here, but rather all the testing of life.
Right. Now, the reason, go back to that one. You had just talked about that one in one of your lessons, I think it was, what was that, Sunday? By various trials, mm-hmm. in this context, referred to ordeals that we encounter in this life rather than those things that would induce us to sin.
Yeah, we talked about tests and trials.
Mm-hmm. Most of us are going through some trials. The more you work for the Lord, I wanted to get this point, the more you work for the Lord, the more trials and things that would come your way. In other words, you're going to be in a battle. You're turning into me and Linda talked about, you'll be a Navy SEAL or Army Ranger. Then you expect to be in more of a battle. Pastor Yvonne and I choose to be more involved in a battle, so we are going through more trials as we speak, you know, today or this week or this month. We are going through some things that we don't talk about. You don't have to go around and broadcast them or talk about them all the time. But as believers, as you get more and more involved in doing things, you're going to be involved in more trials, tests, and then you're going to get it from all sides. Then the enemy is going to come after you. The devil will come after you the more work you do for the Lord. So that's why we have to constantly keep each other lifted up in prayer. Paul went through more trials. He got beat up. He talked about how many times he was put in jail. He was beat up. He was whooped. He was hit with rocks. Peter was beat up and beat up because he did more things. John the Baptist was killed at a very early age because he put himself out there to do the things that God wanted him to do. Jesus called him the greatest prophet of them all, and he died at a very young age. He got his head cut off by Herod, you know, because he called out his sin. When you call out people's sin, they are going to get very upset with you and open the door for the devil to use them to attack you. They don't know that they're being used by the devil, but the devil knows when he attacked you for calling out sin. He want to keep sin undercover. Okay, next one, please. Peter blended five different themes in this letter. He emphasized that Christians can expect suffering as a natural part of a life dedicated to Christ. I can't put too much emphasis on that. When he wrote that letter, now that area that he wrote that letter to is very important. You know, that's why I say watch that video over again. And he commissioned Peter to write that letter to those churches in Ephesus. You know, he emphasized that Christians can expect suffering as a natural part of life when you dedicate your life to Christ. Suffering was God's tool to shape godly character within them. They will get stronger for it. Verse 2, he went on to exhort Christians to live righteous and holy lives in the face of evils that they are experiencing. No matter how tempting it was, Christians were not to return evil for evil. This is a worldly way of doing things, and Christians are not to respond to persecution. And that's why I played that song at the beginning. You will know we are Christian by our love when we do not respond to persecution. When people come after us, we respond in kind with love. No matter how much suffering they experienced, Peter assured the Christians in Asia Minor that they did not deserve it, that the suffering was part of their service to God and his kingdom. Let's go back a little further. Don't go back on the slide, but go back to remember when all the 11 apostles paid dearly for their service to the Lord by being killed or martyred. Although Christians will suffer injustice on this earth, there will come a time when God will right every wrong and reward those who have endured persecution for his name's sake. Any comment on that one, Pastor Yvonne?
No, that's good.
Okay. 4, in light of this, Peter encouraged Christians to submit themselves to others for the sake of the gospel. For the sake of the gospel and for the sake of harmonious impersonal relationships, Christ would eventually judge their actions, and the difficulties they were experiencing would not be an excuse for rebellion or dissensions. In other words, when you're suffering for Christ, count it all joy. But make sure you're suffering for Christ and not something that you're doing outside of Christ. And that's why we have to really understand what sin is and what we ought to do here while we are on planet Earth, and what we ought to turn ourselves or turn away from certain things that would make us suffer. That is not, if we're not doing it for Christ. Make sure you're working for God alone. And that's why we have to really read the Bible and study the Word of God. Finally, Peter used this letter as an opportunity to drive home the central truth of the gospel, that Jesus endured the agony of the cross to save us from our bondage to sin. Let me read that again. Jesus endured the agony of the cross to save us from our bondage to sin. Christ's example, his sinless life, his quiet endurance of suffering, and his commitment to truth should be our model in all the difficulties of this life. In other words, we ought to imitate Christ in every way. And Christ said on the cross, he said, "Forgive them, for they knew not what they do." Okay, now this, you don't have to play this one. This one is for the veterans. You can skip that one and that one, because we taught this lesson at the veteran home, and we wanted to bless the veterans, people who died for us, or they gave up, not died, but sacrificed for us. And, you know, read that for me, Pastor Yvonne.
Finally, these critics claim that the persecutions described in this letter could not have taken place during Peter's lifetime. But none of these arguments is conclusive. Peter was from Galilee, a region that was bilingual. People who grew up there had to know two languages, Greek and Aramaic. As a fisherman functioning in the business world of his day, Peter must have been reasonably fluent in Greek. That is the genuineness of your faith. This is verse 7. That the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls.
Okay. Let me read verse 10 for it. Verse 10, of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, leaven searching what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicated when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that would follow. Amen. I love that scripture. I just wanted to read that one. Go ahead.
Verse 12. To them it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things which angels desire to look upon,
yes,
to look into.
Keep going.
This section is about living before God our Father. In verse 12, it says, Therefore, gird up your loins, the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believed in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God.
Right. Hear that coming. You just made, like you said, we was talking earlier, and we was talking about what's going on in the world today, in the political world, and we both agreed that our faith and hope is in God. It's not in politics. It's not in the world. It's not in anything that's on here on planet Earth. It's our faith and hope is in God. Our home is in God. We are ambassadors here.
But we have to understand.
Yes.
I'm just going to say, we have to understand we live in a fallen world. Mm-hmm. We operate in a with fallen things and fallen ideas and perspectives. And if you don't keep your eyes on the word of God and what God says, and rather choose to believe everything that you hear in the news or on the job or here and there, you know, our bottom line as Christians is the word of God.
Amen.
And, man will always fail you in some way because man is imperfect. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we see different things, but I tell people all the time, my faith is in Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I participate in the world. I participate in things, you know, around me and try to, you know, let my light shine. But at the same time, I know that things are not perfect. And when things fail, I don't fall apart because I already know that. I already know that, you know, people will fail me, that, you know, it's just the nature of man. And so when we understand that a little bit more, then we won't fall apart when things happen. And I think Peter was trying to tell us that in his letter, that, you know, keep your eyes on God, follow God. You're going to have trials, you're going to have tribulation, you're going to have tests, you're going to have persecution, you're going to have all of that. And that was by our own doing. And it's going to be that way until we leave this earth. Oh. But even with all of that, he's telling us to persevere, let your light shine, bring as many people as you can into the fold. Mm-hmm. And, you know, be a good steward, be a good servant. Pastor Sam showed that video at the beginning that we are to be a good servant. And, you know, we treat people better than we treat ourselves.
Even our enemies.
And that's what Jesus was trying to do. When I just saw on Facebook, somebody had put a post that if a preacher If a pastor cannot wash my feet, he cannot be my pastor. And in other words, if you can't do the lowest job in the church, or the lowest job that people would think, is to touch somebody else's feet that walks on the ground and dirt and everything, But we have pretty feet now because we get a little pedicures and things. But
yeah, I was getting ready to say that would not be the lowest job. But back then in Israel, they were walking around in horse manure and all that, So that was
I was trying to say that back in those days, the servant would, when a guest comes to the house, the servant would instantly go get a pail of water and wash and refresh the feet of those people, because they have traveled with their animals. They've walked in just about everything. Their feet was rough and tough and ashy and all kind of stuff. And so to stoop down and to put your hands on, dirty feet like that was the lowest, or was considered the lowest job in the house, or, the servant's job. And Jesus did exactly that the night that he was betrayed. And he told Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you don't have any part of me. And he said, Peter said, well, not only my feet, Lord, but my head and my, my body, my whole body. And so he was trying to teach us how we are to live as servants in this world. Through the persecution, through the trials, through the tribulation, we press to be blessed. And we help others, and we reach out, and we find ways. Like Pastor Sam brought up, I've been taking kids out to lunch. That's been kind of a weekly thing. Some of the kids that we've been, working with, just to get them out of the house. They've been stuck in the house all summer, and some of them are going through some hard stuff. And so I'll tell them, I'm going to pick you up where you want to go. Make up your mind if you want to go to tacos or hamburgers or whatever, a couple of dollars, a couple of bucks, to give these kids a little joy. It's not much,
Sure. Let me share this. In order to be able to turn, and the title was Turn the Other Cheek. In order to be able to turn the other cheek, you have to put yourself in a position where you would have to turn the other cheek, if that makes sense. If you're just sitting in the house alone, just going to church, sitting on the pew, you ain't going to be in a position to have to ever turn the other cheek. But if you get out there and start sharing the word of God, rightly divided, then the enemy is going to put you in a position where you will have to turn the other cheek. And as the other song that we started to say, that you will know we are Christians by our love, then you have to go out there and show your love. You can't show your love set inside of the church. You can't show your love sitting inside of your house. You have to get outside and do some things for the community in this world that we are ambassadors for, to show your love. You have to make yourself available for God to be used by him. And he called, the message was Sunday, you will know your calling. He has something for all of us to do. Peter was a fisherman. He was not educated. He was not he did not go to the synagogue and do all the things that the Jewish leaders was doing. But God can use all of us. I am not a, quote, educated person, but God can use me. God can use everybody in one way or another. I used to enjoy being an usher. My biggest goal was in the helps ministry. I really enjoyed that when I was in the churches. I love doing anything. I guess you could say I love, enjoy washing, being a servant, like the song was saying. That was just part of my calling. And I want to brag, but I was good at doing those things. And, Okay, verse 20, he indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifested in the last time for you, who through him believed in God, raised him from the dead, and gave him glory, so that your faith and your hope are in God. The enduring word. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love for the brethren, love one another with fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abide forever. The term here in that one is born again. You died to the old person. You are not the same person that was born here on planet Earth. You was born again into God's kingdom. This world now is not your home. Because all flesh is as grass, all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withers and its flowers will fade away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now is the word which by gospel was preached to you. Now, this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, amen. Okay, now, is there any question? It was first, the book of 1 Peter and 2 Peter is a very, very exciting book in which we ought to live by today. Any questions? You can end recording, please.
All right.